Jerry the King Lawler. How you doing, Jerry?
George, I'm doing great. Glad to be here, man.
There's two kings in Memphis, you and Elvis, huh?
Well, you know, I've heard that a lot over my career, but I always say, if anybody ever says, oh, you're not the real king, I say, hey, Elvis was the king of rock and roll. I'm the king of wrestling.
That's
two different things.
And, you know, he liked wrestling, too. Because remember, he and I used to come down to the old auditorium with Mr. Coffey, and he'd sneak us in and put us on that stage.
Yes.
And then I don't know if it was you or Mr. Coffey that brought Penny Banner around.
It was Mr. Coffey.
Mr. Coffey.
And she was a very lovely lady wrestler at the time.
She was, and apparently, she was a good wrestler, too, wasn't she?
Yeah, and apparently, I guess, she and Elvis kind of had a couple dates.
We went back out to Graceland, and I sat in the jungle room for about 4 hours waiting on him to come back down.
Maybe she showed him, you know, there's a famous wrestling hold that the girls like to show the guys. It's called a lip lock. You think she put one of those on Elvis?
She may have. But he liked wrestling, you know, because being over there near the auditorium and all. But anyway, Jerry,
speaking of that, before we get off that, one of the coolest pictures, you know, I have a museum now down at the Resorts Casino down in Tunica.
Yeah.
And one of my favorite pictures that we have down there was a picture I found of Elvis actually doing a little mini concert. He's in the wrestling ring. At Ellis Auditorium, I guess I think they said it was like 1956 or something like that. And he's in the ring singing with his band and everything, all in the wrestling ring, which was I thought really cool.
Yeah, I remember that because that evolved into a Goodfellas Milo Dime type thing at Christmas time, and I emceed one of those. And the next year with Bill Black's Combo and Charlie Rich and all. Mm-hmm. And then we drew so many people, we had to move on out because the wrestling was drawing their people.
Right.
And we moved out and did them all over Memphis. Did about 40 years of those shows. But I know what you're talking about.
Yeah, cool. That's a great picture. It's one of my favorite things.
How'd
in the
you get that picture?
You know what? I think it came from Mr. Coffey's collection.
Oh,
you know, Mr.
Okay.
Coffey, I mean, a lot of people don't realize, but he was associated with wrestling for like 40-something years. But he also managed the Ellis Auditorium for years and years. Like you said, he saw everybody that ever came through Memphis.
Coffee.
Yeah, Guy Coffee was a great guy.
And he went to Hume's High School, you know.
Yes, he did. You're
and
right.
He used to hire all of us to sell Cokes and stuff, you know.
And you know what? Another famous guy that became associated with wrestling, the Mouth of the South, Jimmy Hart. He got his start selling Coca-Colas and got the job.
But you got Jimmy Hart into wrestling.
I got Jimmy into wrestling, yeah. He and I were mutual fans of each other, basically. I mean, you know, I went to Treadwell High School, and Jimmy and the Gentries, of course, you know, those guys were all from Treadwell High School,
right.
A little bit before me, but I mean, it was big news. I think, what, like 1965 or 6 or something like that, those guys had that hit, Keep On Dancing.
Keep On Dancing.
They knocked the Beatles off the top of the charts.
That's right.
I mean, you know, they were the talk of Memphis there for a while. I thought it was so cool to be going to the same high school that those guys went to, and I was a big, big fan of them. Then later on, once I got into wrestling, somebody told me, hey, we want you to go into the studio and cut a little record, mostly talking, not, you know, I said, I'm not a singer by any means. And they said, yeah, you know, we're going to surround you with a bunch of good musicians, and this thing is going to turn out good. And it'll be sort of like a song about your character, you know, it's called Bad News. And so I get to the studio there, and here's Jim Dickinson, you know, Jim Dickinson, one of the greatest musicians ever in Memphis, a bunch of guys. And Jimmy Hart was one of the people that they had brought in to sing on the record. And that's where Jimmy and I first became really became good friends, and he was still doing the Gentry gig around town, and I thought, man, this guy's got such personality, such charisma, and I was looking for a kind of a corner man, a second guy, you know, being my corner as a manager. And I said, Jimmy, would you be interested? And man, it just steamrolled from there.
Boy, you got that right. You know, that just reminds me, Jerry. We had you at a couple of Christmas charity shows.
Yeah.
Was it the Gentries that backed you on those shows?
It was. Yes, it was.
Jimmy and people Martin said, and can he sing us? Yeah, he sings good. And of course, you were a big...
I had to quit because of throat problems.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, the audience threatened to cut it. But it was so much fun. I mean, that was something...
Yeah.
It's usually like you see athletes or whatever. They always want to be singers or actors.
Yeah.
Or people that are in whatever career they are, they want to do something different.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
And that was always fun to go in the studio. And I wound up doing about... I did two albums and about 12 singles, you know.
Jerry, you wore many hats, too. A disc jockey, a singer, and a great artist. Because I've seen some of your artwork.
Well, I was that was a God-given talent that I did artwork. I remember drawing from the time I was 5 years old, drawing Superman and Batman and superheroes and all of that sort of stuff. And I was drawing pictures of Superman for my classmates when I should have been doing my homework and things like that. And then later on in the 60s when the Beatles came out, I remember I actually had a job at the shopping center in Ohio drawing with magic markers pictures of John, Paul, George, and Ringo on girls' pillowcases and making money doing that. And then I was fortunate enough, had a great art teacher, Helen Stahl, who still lives up in Hornsby, Tennessee at Treadwell. She put together a portfolio of my artwork and submitted, and I won a full tuition commercial art scholarship to University of Memphis.
Is that right?
And so from there, that's and actually doing drawings of wrestlers is how I got my foot in the door and started my wrestling career with Jackie Fargo and Eddie Bond and guys like that.
Oh, yeah, I remember
You remember, of course, you worked with Eddie Bond over on Channel 13, and those guys helped me get started because of my art career.
Jerry, you've won, but there's one thing people ask me to ask you about, is the situation with Andy Kaufman.
Oh, my gosh.
That's a heck of a story.
You know, it's been over 30 years ago, and I can't go anywhere or do any interview, radio or television or whatever, that it's not mentioned. And just a couple of weeks ago, about 3 weeks ago, TV Guide magazine had a listing of the top 60 moments in pop culture television history. And Andy Kaufman and I are in there when the number one is like when the Beatles debuted on Ed Sullivan. Number two was when Elvis Presley debuted on Ed Sullivan. And for me and Andy Kaufman's appearance on the David Letterman show is in there as one of these iconic moments in the history of television. But yeah, Andy came to Memphis and he wanted to do some wrestling, and he really only wanted to wrestle women.
Yeah.
And so, but then I saw, we got this big star from Hollywood here, and so I kind of tried to figure out a way to get the rub off of this big star, and I worked a match into where Andy and I actually had a match against each other, and I dropped him on his head a couple times with a pile driver, who, by the way, Herbie O'Mill once suggested I'd show you how I did the pile
driver. No, thank you.
You don't want to see that?
No.
Okay. Well, anyway, we wound up going on David Letterman's show, and I became the first talk show guest to ever strike another guest when I slapped Andy out of his chair.
You threw coffee on him?
Well, no, he threw coffee at me after I slapped him out of the chair and everything. But then that became just like one of the most talked about things ever. Right. David Letterman said we've referred to that for years as the famous show.
the famous show.
I mean, that was in the first year of Late Night with David Letterman.
Wow. Jerry, before we go, tell people what I know Monday night and all, but tell people what you're doing.
Well, of course, I do Monday Night Raw, host Monday Night Raw, which is on USA Network every Monday night at 7 o'clock here in Memphis, and have been doing that for over 20 years now, over 1,000 consecutive shows there on Monday Night Raw. And I have the museum, and we're doing some local shows down at Resorts Casino. Every couple of months, and we got another one coming up right after Christmas, and just staying on the road doing all sorts of things.
Jerry, I want to ask you also before you go quickly, who was your favorite wrestler?
Oh my gosh. You mean the favorite guy to wrestle against?
Either one.
Well, I mean, my favorite, all-time favorite of all time was Jackie Fargo. Jackie Fargo right here in Memphis. But over the years, I got to wrestle. And he was really one of my favorite opponents, too. But I'd have to throw Bill Superstar Dundee in there and Handsome Jimmy Valiant. You remember Handsome Jimmy Valiant.
And
The boy from New York City. He was so charismatic. And so the people in Memphis just loved that guy. And so, Jackie Fargo, Bill Dundee, and Handsome Jimmy Valiant got to be my all-time
favorite. Hey, Jerry, thanks for coming down, man.
George,
we checked you Monday night on
USA
again.
Network, Monday
and
Night
And you
Raw.
Told me worldwide how many people watch that show.
Oh, only about 300 million every single week see the WWE programming worldwide. We're on 126 different countries.
Well, if you see Jimmy Hart on the road, tell him I said hello.
I'll do it.
Jerry, thanks a lot for coming down.
Thanks, George.
Memphis Sounds with GK.